So in terms of the structure of my presentation, I will begin by motivating why it's important to examine the factors that drive FDI, and then present some trends and patterns of FDI in the region, specifically placing Central Asia in a comparative context with the rest of the region. Central Asia, as we will see, is quite different from the rest of Asia, both in terms of the volume of FDI it receives and in terms of the sectoral composition. And then I'll move to a more formal regression analysis, which looks at how factors capturing comparative advantage, integration, and institutional quality affect FDI inflows. And then finally, specifically, look at how international investment agreements, which is an increasingly employed instrument of the trade and investment policy regimes of countries in the, not only in the region, but globally, how that affects FDI. So why do we look at the drivers of FDI? So research and experiences around the world have shown that FDI can contribute to inclusive economic growth. It can do so by creating jobs, providing much needed capital and infrastructure investments through technology and skill transfers, and facilitating trade and global value chain participation. But research and experiences around the world have also shown that benefits are not automatic and vary by the type of FDI and the specific country context and the absorptive capacity of the recipient country. So when we talk about the type of FDI, we can think of different classifications. So for example, multinationals can either enter a market through merger and acquisitions or by building new assets, which is called greenfield investment. And both of these have very different welfare implications depending on the human capital and institutional quality of the host country. Similarly, if you think about sectoral composition, FDI in extractive industries or natural resources has often proved to be less beneficial to the host economy compared to manufacturing. And to benefit from FDI in natural resources, it's important to supplement the investment regime with the right institutional framework, which minimizes rent seeking and mostly rent seeking. And FDI flowing into Asia has mostly been in the manufacturing sector, and it's been trade promoting and facilitated participation in value chains. So over the past few decades, multinationals have compartmentalized their production processes and relocated these in search of lower production costs in order to export to the international market, which allows participation in global value chains. So in other words, rather than producing a good from start to finish in one economy, countries can now specialize in certain parts of the production process. And it's a very successful export-oriented development strategy followed by many economies in East and Southeast Asia. In this regard, Central Asia has lagged behind a little bit. And once we come to the formal analysis, we get a sense of why that's so. So in essence, from a policy perspective, it is important to understand the drivers of FDI that promote investments most in line with the development policy objectives of the host country. So just presenting some overall trends and characteristics of FDI in the region. So Asia and Pacific is the largest destination of FDI in the world and attracts more than a third of global flows at almost $500 billion. And a lot of this FDI comes from within the region. Intra-Asian FDI has been increasing over time to reach half of total FDI inflows to the region in 2015. At the same time, Asian investors are also increasingly investing outside the region, especially through merger and acquisitions. In this chart, we can see the sub-regional breakdown a bit more clearly. So East Asia consistently remains the largest recipient of FDI inflows into the region, and Central Asia the smallest. So the dotted line here shows the intra-regional share, which stood at 52% in 2015. So this is based on standard balance of payment data, which does not identify the global ultimate owner. So for example, if Chinese investors are investing through Hong Kong in Australia, BOP data will record Hong Kong as the source of the investment. So it does not capture the phenomena of round-tripping or trans-shipping and might slightly distort when we look at FDI patterns and trends. So in our report, we actually employ firm-level data that traces the ultimate global ownership of the investment. So in my previous example, this data would identify China as the source of investment in Australia rather than Hong Kong. So this data differentiates by mode of entry, that is between merger and acquisitions and greenfield. So based on this, we can see that the intra-regional share is only 45% rather than 52, which indicates that around 7% of FDI recorded by balance of payment as intra-Asian may actually be outside investors routing investments to the region through other Asian countries. Another thing this chart shows is that historically, greenfield investments have been the preferred mode of entry for investments into Asian countries, but merger and acquisitions have been increasing in importance, especially those from outside the region. One thing to clarify here is that this data records FDI both by the number of projects and the dollar value. But the dollar value often has to be estimated, especially for merger and acquisitions, which do not record the exact value due to confidentiality reasons quite often. So the information on FDI based on the number of projects is considered more reliable and is the one that we'll use in our formal analysis. But before moving on to the formal analysis, let's look at some more trends and patterns, specifically for Central Asia. So looking at the top destinations of FDI in the sub-region, we can see that Kazakhstan is the biggest recipient for both greenfield investments and merger and acquisitions. But going down the list, you can see the rankings depend on whether you look at the number of projects or the dollar values. So for example, Azerbaijan is the second largest recipient in terms of the number of projects, but Uzbekistan is the second largest in terms of the dollar value of investments. This chart shows the top sources of investment into the sub-region. So for greenfield investments, investors from the Russian Federation are the largest, both in terms of the number of projects and dollar value. So this, I guess, is not surprising. But for merger and acquisitions, while Russian investors invest most frequently, in terms of the size of the investment, they're not at the top. The other interesting thing this chart shows is the importance of the People's Republic of China as a source of FDI in Central Asia. Next to place Central Asia in comparison with other sub-regions in terms of the overall volume of FDI, we can see that for both greenfield and M&As, Central Asia receives a very small share of FDI to Asia, 3% of total greenfield projects and only 1% of total merger and acquisitions coming to the region. Breaking down FDI by sectoral composition, again we see how Central Asia differs from the rest of the region. It receives a much larger share of its FDI in the primary sector, that is the natural resources sector. So in terms of greenfield investments, whereas Asia as a whole receives 5% of total FDI in that sector, Central Asia receives almost 11%. And this is even more pronounced for merger and acquisitions, with 31% of total investment projects in the sub-region coming to the natural resource sector, and much smaller in manufacturing. Let's also see the sectoral composition of intra-Asian FDI and how this has changed over time. So this chart shows that while intra-Asian greenfield investments are more popular, similar to FDI from outside Asia, merger and acquisitions have been catching up. This chart also shows that the services sector has become increasingly important for intra-Asian investments. In fact, most of the increase in intra-Asian investments over time has come from merger and acquisitions, especially in the services sector, if you look at the right-hand side panel. Manufacturing shows a more mixed picture, and intra-Asian investments in the natural resources sector has actually declined, coinciding with the commodity price shocks over the last few years. So this chart shows how different sub-regions are connected within the sub-region and to other sub-regions of Asia and the rest of the world. So you can see that in terms of both Greenfield and M&A, Central Asia is the least connected intra-sub-regionally. And even intra-regionally, that is including both intra-sub-regional and inter-sub-regional, it's behind most other sub-regions, especially for Greenfield investments. Moving on to the formal regression analysis. So the dependent variable here is the number of bilateral investment projects. And we estimate a standard gravity equation which specifies bilateral FDI as a function of different host and source country characteristics, including economic size and other factors, and also bilateral resistance terms which include distance, common language, contiguity, etc. And we estimate this equation using the Poisson pseudo maximum likelihood methodology, which is the state of the art in the literature these days. Please note here that each row is a different regression with only the most important explanatory variables reported here for gravity. So among the country characteristics, we include a whole bunch of factors to capture institutional quality, business environment, comparative advantage, integration. And we found that institutional quality as measured by subjective perception-based world governance indicators is the most important factor in explaining FDI inflows. And moreover, comparing the first four columns with the next four columns, we find that institutional quality is even more important for merger and acquisitions than for greenfield. Reason being that greenfield investments are often located in special economic zones where they may be shielded from the domestic institutional environment, whereas merger and acquisitions are rarely shielded from the domestic environment. The other interesting finding here is that institutional quality is more important when the investors are from high-income countries compared to emerging country investors. That is, North-South FDI is more sensitive to the institutional quality of the host country compared to South-South FDI. We then look at the various sub-components of the world governance indicators. So in total, there are six different dimensions of this indicator, and we test for which of those are most important. We find that the regulatory quality and government effectiveness are the most important dimensions of institutional quality, especially for merger and acquisitions. Next, we look at the various factors that explain GVC FDI, or FDI that promotes trade and participation in value chains. So as previously mentioned, most of the FDI coming to Asia is trade promoting and carried out by multinationals using economies in the region as a production base. And this has underpinned the phenomena of factory Asia, but so far Central Asia has lagged behind the rest of the region in this regard. So in these regressions, GVC FDI is captured by foreign-owned affiliates that both import and export, as opposed to those that serve the domestic market. And we find essentially here that GVC FDI is in Asia is attracted to economies with abundant labor, low trade barriers, and with more downstream exports. So upstreamness or downstreamness refers to the position in the production process, with natural resource extraction being most upstream and final assembly being most downstream. So these findings provide an insight into why Central Asia may have lagged behind. Labor costs in the sub-region are comparatively higher. And given the reliance on natural resources, the structure of exports is very upstream. So finally, looking at the role of bilateral investment treaties. So BITs are agreements which provide foreign investors substantial rights in terms of the security of their investments and rights to repatriate their profits. The number of BITs has been proliferating globally and also within the region since 1990. But these still vary greatly in terms of the structure and the strength of different provisions present in the agreements. So we broadly group all provisions into five different categories covering different areas of investor protection. And let me just mention ISDM, Investor State Dispute Mechanism, which allows international arbitration to private investors in disputes with states. And this has been quite controversial in the news recently. And you can see across all categories, Asian BID provisions have been becoming more substantive to foreign investors over the last three decades, except for ISDM, where there was a decline from 2001 to 2012. So in the formal analysis, we compare how each of these different categories help to attract FDI, and we find that ISDM is the most important provision. Once you control for ISDM in a given regression, none of the other categories of provisions explain FDI at any level of statistical significance. So despite the fact that ISDM have decreased in terms of intra-Asian BITs over this last time period, it's important from a policy perspective to include ISDM in BITs to provide adequate protection to investors. So let me just recap the key messages from our special team. So benefits from FDI, as we discussed, are not automatic and depend on the type of FDI and specific country context. And we find that institution quality proxied by perception-based measures of regulatory quality and government effectiveness and ease of doing business matters significantly for attracting FDIs, especially merger and acquisitions. In Asia, FDI is closely related to global value chains, with abundant labor, low trade barriers, and downstream specialization helping to attract trade promoting FDI. And for bilateral investment treaties, investor state dispute mechanism appears to be crucial in inducing FDI. Thank you.